Hello, my dear girls and boys, a very warm good evening to all of you, and thank you very much for staying tuned to HashLearn. This is Kushbu again, and we are going to discuss about the respiratory disorders today. But before we move ahead, okay, let us discuss the recap of the class, what we have discussed in the previous class. And just give me some second, I can't actually see the comments. So it will take time. So meanwhile, we can start off the class, and then once the comment or chat section comes, I will respond to that. Okay. So in recap, what we have discussed in the previous class, the pulmonary volumes, so the various volumes, and then oxygen transport, and then carbon dioxide transport. Okay, so this is what we have discussed, like how oxygen is transported and how carbon dioxide is transported in the blood. Now the CPP question which was given to you, where most of you have gone wrong, is this question. So the question says, arrange the following in the order. So arrange the following in the order. So the first one is tidal volume, second one is residual volume, third one is expiratory reserve volume, and the fourth one is vital capacity. So most of you have opted for the option A, okay, but actually it should be tidal volume is the lowest one, then you have the expiratory reserve volume, and less than that you have residual volume, and then we have the vital capacity. Okay, so this is again, it was a normal question only. Yes, now I can see. So here there are many by now. So Divyansh, good evening. Ritika, good evening. And is this your first class, Ritika? Then Radhika, Yogesh, Smaranika. Okay, a very warm good evening to all of you. So this is the CPP question where most of you have gone wrong. Now goals for this class is what we are going to discuss is control of respiration, like how respiration is controlled, and then respiratory disorders. Okay, and after that we will be discussing a few questions also. So here we have the nervous control. So we have control of respiration. Okay, Ritika, welcome on board. Linoleic acid is actually the essential fatty acid. Okay, the ones which are required for your body, or the ones which the body cannot form, that is said, and those are the essential fatty acid, and linoleic acid is an example of essential fatty acid. Okay, Radhika. Now nervous control. So first, so in case of control of respiration, we have two types of control. First one is nervous control, and second one is chemical control. Nervous control is actually by the inspiratory and expiratory centers, which are present in our the medulla oblongata, okay, and the pons veruli. Pons veruli, medulla oblongata, this actually makes the brain stem. So in the chapter neural coordination, we will be further discussing this things, okay, ki what is the position of that. But as of now we are into control of respiration. So nervous control, for control of respiration, following respiratory centers are found in the hind brain. So that's the hind brain, the back part of the brain, forebrain, midbrain. I cannot locate it from here. So forebrain is the frontal part, midbrain inside, and then this is the hind brain. So in the hind brain we have a few centers, like inspiratory center, expiratory center, and then apneustic center, pneumotactic center, and then gasping center as well. Good evening, Akshay. So here inspiratory center, inspiratory center and expiratory center, these two centers are present in the medulla oblongata. So this is present in medulla oblongata. where is the apneustic center and pneumotactic center and gasping center. These three are present in the pons region. Okay, or pneumotactic, more precisely, it's pons veroli. So here, now next question, we are moving into the next part. So let's see the diagram. So you have the pneumotactic center. So see, this is the pontine region. So we have the pneumotactic center present here. Then this is the apneustic center. This is dorsal respiratory center, and that is also called as the inspiratory center, the one which we have discussed. This is the medulla oblongata, and this is ventral respiratory center, and that is the expiratory center, and that controls both inspiration and expiration. Okay. Now, in this case, how it is controlled when you are breathing normally? Okay. Akshay, could you please post your question again? So dentition and all, Radhika, we will come to that, but as of now we are into respiration, so let's first do this. If time permits, we'll do that, or neither, we can calculate that again. Okay, sometime we will do that. So inspiratory centers, which is there. So in this case, when we are normally breathing, so remember, they recall the mechanism of breathing. In case of normal breathing, there are two muscles which are involved, that is external intercostal muscle and the diaphragm muscles. Okay, so the muscles of the diaphragm and external intercostal muscles, when they contract, inspiration takes place, and when they relax, expiration will take place. And in that case, the area which is active is your inspiratory area. Okay, so if inspiratory area, when it is active, it will be active for 2 seconds. Okay, and once it is activated, it will cause the diaphragm and external intercostal muscles to contract, as a result of which inspiration takes place. Inspiration will take place. Okay, now after this, if that becomes inactive, so this is the active condition of inspiratory area. In case it becomes inactive, that condition is there for 3 seconds, and in this case, both these muscles, the muscles of diaphragm and the muscles of external intercostal muscles, okay, they will relax, as a result of which expiration takes place. So this is the case of normal inspiration and expiration. But when it comes to labored inspiration or forceful inspiration and forceful exhalation, then in that case, this inspiratory area will also activate the expiratory area. And then when expiratory area is activated, in that case, the expiratory muscles, the internal intercostal muscles and the abdominal muscles, they will get contracted. As a result of that, the volume of chest cavity further decreases and forceful expiration takes place. And also at the same time, in case of forceful inhalation also, other than the muscles of diaphragm and external intercostal muscles, these two which is there, you have, other than this, there are muscles like pectoralis minor, all these will be contracting and there will be forceful inhalation, so that the volume of the chest cavity increases. So this is the neural control of the respiratory centers. In this, now next is the, so here you remember, see, you can see here we have the muscles which are bringing messages, and this is the position for the vagus muscle. Why I'm talking about this? Because in chemical coordination it will come, or chemical control of inspiration. So in case of chemical control of inspiration, it is controlled by carbon dioxide level in the arterial blood and the cerebrospinal blood. Okay. I think there is, so actually it will be, see, in there are receptors in the carotid artery, So there are two carotids, left and right carotid. So there we have the receptors, and that receptors will send signals to the 9th cranial nerve, that is gastropharyngeal nerve. Okay, in the previous diagram itself, see, this is the gastropharyngeal nerve. So 9th cranial nerve, that will take a reception from where? From the carotid receptors. Okay, and then we have central chemoreceptors, and they are present in the ventral surface of the medulla. Okay, fine. And after that, even in the aortic arch, we have the receptors, and that receptors will send signal to the 10th cranial nerve, the vagus nerve. Okay, so these nerves, what kind of a signal they send? They detect the concentration of carbon dioxide, oxygen, and also the pH of the blood. Okay, and accordingly they will send the message or pass the information to the brain's rhythmicity centers. So these centers which are there, that is called rhythmicity centers, and the latter then sends appropriate nerve impulses to the respiratory muscles. Okay, so that means the respiratory muscles are what? The abdominal muscles, the diaphragm, or the intercostal muscles. So accordingly, if you need to increase the rate of inhalation or decrease the rate of breathing, that kind of a information will come, and accordingly the rate of breathing is changed, and it will remain so unless and until the normal levels of carbon dioxide and oxygen is regained. Okay, so now there is a question that concentration of carbon dioxide or oxygen, which of the two affects the rhythmicity or affects the centers more? The breathing will be affected more by difference in carbon dioxide concentration or oxygen concentration. So now we are into the disorders of respiratory system. Okay, so I hope that regulation of respiration is clear. We have two controls, one is neural control and other one is the chemical control. In chemical control, it was amount of carbon dioxide, oxygen, and pH which is detected, and the detections will be by carotid artery. So actually it is common carotid artery which has carotid bodies present on the surface of it, not the artery. Carotid bodies will detect, and they send the signal to the 9th cranial nerve. The on the aortic arch, you have the aortic bodies which will send the signal to the 10th cranial nerve, which is vagus nerve, and accordingly your body will act. And yes, now I have the answer, that is carbon dioxide concentration. And Akshay, Ritika, Yogesh, Radhika, Smarnika, very good. So it is carbon dioxide concentration which influences the rate of breathing more than the oxygen concentration of the blood. Okay, so now we are into the some of the disorders of respiratory system. So first disorder is the hypoxia, and it is the condition of oxygen storage in the tissues. Okay, or less of oxygen available to the cells, but it is not available to the cells. So there are two kinds of hypoxias possible. One is artificial hypoxia. So it results from storage of oxygen in the air as at high altitude. It causes, like in case of high altitude, okay, so it should be shortage. So it is the condition of oxygen shortage and not storage. Okay, so what happens in this case? In high altitudes, the oxygen level will be very less, and that is why people feel mountain sickness, which is characterized by breathlessness, headache, dizziness, nausea, vomiting. Because see, that is one of the reason when we travel across, or when we travel to hilly regions, what happens is the percentage of oxygen or the atmospheric pressure is very low, and that is one of the reason why it is said that you should not fill your stomach. Okay, don't eat too much when you are going for mountain climbing or anything of that kind, because already the atmospheric pressure is less and your condition is going to be worse, and then if you eat too much, the metabolic rate of your body will be high, so there will be imbalance in your body. Yes, there will be more RBCs in persons living in the mountain region, because the affinity of hemoglobin towards oxygen is less, okay, when the pressure decreases, atmospheric pressure is decreased. So because of that, the affinity of hemoglobin towards oxygen is decreased. So in order to fulfill the oxygen demand of the body, okay, it is the juxtaglomerular apparatus of the kidney which will release erythropoietin, which will increase the RBC numbers in the person, okay. And then when we have anemic hypoxia, and this results due to the reduced oxygen carrying capacity of blood due to anemia. So anemia is a condition where you have less of RBC, okay. So oxygen carrier is not there, so obviously deficiency of oxygen will be there. And then carbon monoxide poisoning. So carbon monoxide can actually bind irreversibly with the hemoglobin. Oxygen binding to hemoglobin is reversible, okay. So the moment partial pressure and all changes, oxygen will be released. But carbon monoxide can bind to hemoglobin 200 to 250 times more strongly than oxygen. Okay, that is why once carbon monoxide binds to the hemoglobin, that hemoglobin becomes useless. It cannot carry oxygen anymore. Okay, so that's how the amount of oxygen available to the tissues is reduced. Now it is the condition of asphyxia. So the oxygen content of blood falls and carbon dioxide content rises. If this condition is there, and this is the condition when some kind of suffocation takes place, okay. So suffocation is nothing but the available carbon dioxide in the air is less for you, and as a result more of carbon dioxide is there in the blood. I think a day before yesterday, in last to last class of mine, the contest question was like that only, ki what will happen if the carbon dioxide concentration of the blood is increased to your breathing, okay. So that is somewhere related to this. But yes, if asphyxia condition is prolonged, okay, so this will lead to ultimately death of the person, and that is death due to suffocation. And what happens in that, the oxygen level is very very reduced and carbon dioxide level is very high. Now then the third disorder is bad cold. Cold is bad only when you get it, when it comes like a disease. So disease causing microbes present in the air attack the respiratory tract, okay, and depends upon which part of your respiratory tract is affected, you have different kinds like rhinitis, sinusitis, pharyngitis or laryngitis, okay. So in this case what happens, this microbes attacks the respiratory tract and it produces inflammation of the mucous membrane in the various regions and increases the secretion, and that is why we have the running nose or more of mucus formation, cough during these events. Are you all listening to me, or is the comment by Joshna is the last comment? More RBCs persons living in the mountain region. So what is the different type? If it is rhinitis, that means the nasal chambers are inflamed or it is attacked by the microbe, okay. Sinusitis, so if you remember the first class of respiration, we have talked about the various sinuses, okay. So those sinuses, if they are infected, then in case it is called sinusitis. Then pharyngitis, it is the, okay fine, I can see. I thought maybe the comment has stopped coming. So thank you Joshna, Yogesh, Radhika and Smaranika. So in case of pharyngitis, it is the pharynx which is infected, or inflammation of pharynx takes place, and that is also sometimes told as, or it is said as, sore throat, and it is usually accompanied by tonsillitis, that is inflammation of tonsils. Okay. Thank you Akshay. And I will come to your question also, don't worry, because well, I take that as a good comment, like it's an appreciation for me. I think it was that only and not any sarcasm. And then laryngitis is the inflammation of the larynx. So it comes from the name of the organ, larynx, laryngitis, sinus, sinusitis, pharynx, pharyngitis. And this causes the hoarse voice and difficulty in speaking. Why? Because see, this gentleman is the voice box. So if that is inflamed, obviously you will have the hoarse voice and difficulty in speaking. Okay. So that next is bronchitis. So that is the inflammation of the bronchi. Okay, so recall the structure of your respiratory system, bronchi, where it is there. So the cause for a bronchitis is infectious microbes present in the air result in hypertrophy or hyperplasia. Okay, so overgrowth of these, of the seromucous gland and goblet cells. Okay, so goblet cells, again it has come, which is present in the bronchi. So these cells secrete mucus. Okay, so that is infection of that as a result of overgrowth of that. So more and more mucus is secreted. So as a result of this, inflammation of the bronchi take place. And bronchitis, it's not only because of this. This can also be there because of cigarette smoking and exposure to air pollutants such as carbon monoxide. Okay, so we are even if you do, if you have bronchitis, that doesn't mean that you are always infected by the microbe. If you have any of these wonderful habit, that means cigarette smoking, or unfortunately if you are living in a polluted area, so you are very, very susceptible to this disease. Okay, though I use the word wonderful, that was in sarcasm. Cigarette smoking is always injurious to your health. Okay, now symptom: regular coughing with thick greenish yellow sputum. Okay, so that is the symptom for the bronchitis. So it's actually a prolonged thing. Avoiding, and what is the prevention and curative measure? So you should avoid exposure to smoke, chemicals and pollutants. So any kind of pollutants, and that's why these days the areas which are more polluted. Okay, so the areas which are more polluted, there you will find people traveling with mask. Okay, because that will directly affect your respiratory system, because we know we are not going to eat in air, so you are closing your digestive system. Okay, ears and all that won't affect so much, but inhalation and exhalation you cannot stop, and the moment you are out in a polluted air, it is bound to affect your health. Then if the condition is there, then you can take suitable antibiotics so that it is cured, because it is caused by even the microorganisms. So if you take, okay, this antibiotics, it will be cured. And then bronchodilator drugs are used to widen the bronchial passage, because too much of mucus secretion actually blocks the bronchial passage, and that's why the person will feel difficulty in breathing. So bronchodilators, they expand or widen the bronchi, as a result of bronchial passage, by relaxing the smooth muscles. Fine. So because of that, or this is one of the ways by which that can be cured, but remember, always prevention is better than cure. Bronchial asthma. So it is an allergic attack of breathlessness associated with bronchial obstruction and spasm. Okay, so this thing you need to remember, that in which disease which part is affected and what happens. Okay, say for example, it's not a disease, just hiccups. So that is because of which parts? Contraction and relaxation. Hiccups will cause due to dash, or contraction of dash. So this you need to remember, ki where exactly which part is affected. So here you have allergic attack and you have the bronchial obstruction only due to spasm of the bronchitis. So the person feels problem in breathing. Now cause. So and symptoms: so bronchial asthma is generally caused due to hypersensitivity, that is your allergy of bronchioles to the foreign substance, the allergen. So hypersensitivity is allergy, and foreign substance is your allergen, the one which causes the allergy. Yes, Radhika, very good. It's the diaphragm. Hiccups are caused due to the movement of the diaphragm, and good, Joshna, as well. Okay, so the goblet cell lining the respiratory passage starts secreting excess mucus, which clogs the bronchi, and this event is very, very fast. Okay, usually the microbe will attack and then mucus will be there, but this event is fast and very vigorous. Now preventive and curative measures include: best preventive measure is avoiding exposure to foreign substance, that means avoid the allergen in total. So you need to avoid the allergen. Obviously, if you do not encounter the allergen, there won't be any attack. And yes, even I can see Smarnika has also answered. So good, Smarnika. Now, if a patient is sensitive to some allergen, then other preventive measure is hyposensitization. Okay, so any hyposensitization is a method where actually in this method you will be made less sensitive to that particular allergen. So that is one of the methods by which excessive allergy can be prevented. And then treatment involves antibiotic therapy and use of bronchodilator drugs or inhalers, which will immediately, the bronchodilator, because of the mucus, bronchiole is, or bronchi is, the diaphragm is reduced, okay, the bronchi diameter is reduced. So bronchodilator will increase its diameter and the normal breathing will be restored, okay. So we have just discussed this, I guess, yes. Next is disorders of the respiratory system, and in that we have the next is the pneumonia. So acute infection due to inflammation of alveoli of lung, okay. So pneumonia is the condition where you have the inflammation of alveoli of the lung. This is important, the site you should remember. And then it is caused mainly due to the infection caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae, that is a bacteria, but it can, pneumonia can be caused by other microbes as well. But this is the most favorite gentleman for pneumonia. So in such patients, the uptake of oxygen is adversely affected due to inflamed alveoli filled with excess mucus. So see, alveoli is the site where gaseous exchange takes place. Now that area itself is filled with mucus. So that will obviously hinder the exchange of gases. Okay. And as a result, the uptake of oxygen will be affected and the oxygen supplies to the tissues will be reduced. Prevention and cure in immunocompromised patients. So that pneumonia can take place even in the immunocompromised patient, that means where the immunity has already reduced. Okay, it can be with aging or it can be because of some other disease. So in that case, it can be prevented by proper and timely vaccination. Okay, so that the microbe cannot infect at first place itself. Then use of antibiotics kill the pathogen, and symptomatic treatment in the form of bronchodilator. So symptomatic treatment means it is based on just the symptom, like symptom of pneumonia will be what, facing difficulty in breathing due to constriction of the respiratory tract. So you have bronchodilator, so it's just a symptomatic treatment. Next is emphysema. So emphysema is caused due to inflammation or abnormal distension of the bronchial and alveolar sac, resulting in the loss of elasticity. So we know that our lung is very well or very much elastic in nature. Okay. So if this elasticity of lungs is lost, obviously we will have the breathing problem, and this results due to the abnormal distension of bronchial and alveolar sac. The cause is cigarette smoking and chronic bronchitis. Okay, if bronchitis is there for long time, so that is called chronic bronchitis, are the cause of this disease. The alveolar sac remains filled with air even after expiration, and ultimately the lung size increases. Lung size increases, but the capacity or the elasticity of lung will be reduced. Okay, and prevention, avoiding exposure to cigarette smoke and pollutants, because anything which is causing prolonged bronchitis will actually cause the this also, emphysema. Eventually it will lead to emphysema. As emphysema is chronic lung disease resulting in irreversible, see this is important, it is irreversible distension and loss of elasticity of alveoli, it cannot be cured permanently. However, treatment may limit the progression of the disease. Okay, the disease should not become even worse, where it is, it should be stopped there. That can be done. So So that is why for this, the best thing is to avoid, prevent yourself from getting to that condition, because there is no reversal from there. And then symptomatic treatment involves use of bronchodilator, antibiotics or oxygen therapy. So these are again symptomatic treatments only, and they cannot cure the disease. Now on your screen is the previous class contest question, and the question which sir asked was, cockroach has come to India from dash country. So even after the contest, sir gave you the hint also, the scientific name for the cockroach, so that is Periplaneta americana. So Periplaneta americana is actually the most studied variety of the cockroach, okay. Other than that also we have many species of it. So Periplaneta americana, so it is from America, and the first person to answer this question was Yogesh. So a big round of applause for Yogesh, and congratulations Yogesh, you will get your free atom session credited by the end of this class, and keep it up. And now on your screen will come today's contest question. Answer the question, and it's easy. So the question, here it comes. In hamburgers phenomenon, which ion is transported? A. Magnesium ion, B. Sodium ion, C. Chloride ion, D. Potassium ion. Hamburgers phenomenon we have discussed in the last class itself. So next is occupational respiratory disorder. So what is occupational? That means it is associated with occupation, and occupational respiratory disorders will come mostly when the person is exposed to more number of years, like some 10 to 15 years, okay. And the common examples of that are silicosis and asbestosis. They are common occupational lung diseases, and they are caused due to chronic exposure. That means exposure for a long time to silica. So silica will cause silicosis, asbestos dust will cause asbestosis dust respectively in mining industry. As a result of chronic exposure, there is fibrosis of the upper part of the lung, and that causes the inflammation, okay. And symptoms appear after chronic exposure only. So you can see the time frame. So by that time this happens, you do not know what is going on inside the body, but for long term when it happens, then only you will get the symptoms. And more problem with these, the occupational disorders, is that it cannot be reversed. They are incurable. Okay, so it can be controlled. So that is why best thing is that we have the preventive measures. So occupational drug, occupational lung disorder are incurable. Therefore, preventive measures are only alternative. Which one? And it's not me who gives the atom session, dear. You give the answer, so you get the atom session, Radhika. So I can just thank you in behalf of the entire organization. So what are the preventive measures we can have? Use of protective gears and clothing by the workers. Okay, so since it is in the form of dust, the protective gear like mask should be there properly, and the clothings as well. Then the workers, should be free, should be informed about the risk of exposure to such dust. Okay, so the workers who are working in that scenario should be informed about the risk of, or what are the risks of that occupation, because most of the people do not even know what they are doing and what it will cause to their body. regular health checkup of workers is required, and brief holiday from duty at short intervals for such workers is needed. Okay, so that you give the lungs the proper space and time. Okay, okay, got it, Radhik. So now we are into the question answer segment, and on your screen there is question. So we will have some 5 questions based on this graph only. So in every question this graph will come. So now answer this question based on this graph, because this is the part of the chapter which I feel needs the maximum understanding, and if once you understand, it's done, frozen. So blood can combine with almost dash, so you have to talk about the what amount of oxygen if hemoglobin is 100% saturated. So what should be the answer for this question? So here if you see, see, this is the 100% saturation, so that belongs to what amount? The 20 ml ka amount. So that is why the correct answer will be C. Okay, so that's how you have to look into the graph. So I'll just explain the graph once, and then we can go for the coming questions. So this side is showing you the saturation. So if it is talking about saturation, you have to look for this side. If it is talking about oxygen content, this line. And if it is talking about partial pressure of oxygen, then you have to go for the bottom. So there are 3 things, and you have to look for region A, B, and then D, E, F we have. So based on that, we have the coming questions. So now next question, try answering that. Which of these is incorrect regarding A and B in the given graph? A is deoxygenated blood leaving the tissues. B is reduced blood returning from tissues. Then C, A is oxygenated blood leaving the lungs. And D, B is deoxygenated blood in the systemic veins. Are you all there? Let me check. Okay, so I think you people are answering, but the questions are not coming. The response is not coming to me. So in this case, if you see, we have talked about, so here A is deoxygenated blood leaving the tissues. So is this the deoxygenated state? No, this is the oxygenated state. B is reduced blood returning from the tissues. Yes, it is very much correct. Okay, that is reduced blood. Then A is oxygenated blood leaving the lungs. So this is oxygenated blood leaving the lungs because it is saturated. It has maximum oxygen, so it will be in the lungs only. And then B is deoxygenated blood in the systemic veins. Okay, so that is also again correct. So you were supposed to find out the incorrect, so the answer will be A. Now next question, try this out. Okay, so somehow I cannot see your comments. It has actually because of some internet issue. So I'll be just discussing the question, and you can match the answers with your answer. So here, how much oxygen will be released to the tissues by blood on passing from lungs to the tissues? So once it is passing from the lungs to the tissues, how much oxygen will be released from passing from lungs to the tissues? So when it is in lungs, okay, it is at this saturation level, and in the tissues, how much is the percentage of the, or what is the partial pressure of oxygen. So, in tissues we know the partial pressure of oxygen is 40. Okay. So, here if we see this 40 belongs to the 15 figure. So, you just need to minus it out, 20 minus 15. So, it is 5 ml of oxygen per 100 ml of blood. That amount will be released from, released by the blood on passing from lungs to the tissues. Now, next question is this. During strenuous exercise in the muscle interstitial fluid, partial pressure of oxygen falls to 20 mm of mercury. The oxygen delivered by blood that passes through the exercise muscle tissues will be 5 times as much as the normal, 3 times as much as the normal, double to the normal. So, I am just discussing it because your comments are not there. Okay. So, you can just correlate it. I am just speaking that time and again so that there is no confusion. So, in this case you can see in the previous case what we have seen, it was 5 ml which is given to the tissues. Now, it is talking that if it falls to 20. So, if it falls to 20, so what will be the difference? 20 minus 5, so it will be 15 ml. So, 15 ml will be given. Okay. So, that is why. So, and in the previous question, if we see, we have found out it is 5. In normal condition, it is 5. In case of strenuous exercise, it is 15. So, it will be 3 times as much as the normal condition. Then, the next question, which of these is correct regarding D, E, and F? So, this we have to look for areas in the graph. So, D shows the venous blood in exercise. Obviously, just now the previous question, D shows the venous blood. That is correct. E shows the normal venous blood. E shows the normal venous blood. That is also correct. F shows the normal arterial blood. Yes, oxygenated blood. So, this is also correct. So, the answer will be D, all of these. And I hope you have understood the questions that how I have solved it. And I will go through your comments just in case you have posted any comment. And I will address that in the next class because here it has stopped. Okay. So, to summarize what we have discussed today, respiratory organs, and then we have actually discussed the mechanism, like how the respiration is controlled, and then the different respiratory disorders. And with this, we have come to an end of the class, and this is your CPP time. So, please do practice the class practice pack. That is very important. And just in case you have any doubt, you can ask in the coming class about this class. Regarding this class, if you have any issues, you can ask in the coming classes. And till then, I take your leave. Good night, Shubhratri, Shabbakhair, and passport users, start solving the question right away. Good luck.